any rate, delighted to have Essam Delacroix talk about asymptotic meanders with fixed number of bigons.
Thank you very much.
So first of all, it is a joint work with Elise, Peter Zodrat, and Anton Zorich. And yeah, as I have many pictures to show, I decided to make some slides. Do the chart later. So first, what are meanders? So you pick a pair of curves on the sphere. There is the blue curve and the red curve. Red is gamma 1 and blue is gamma 2. So here are three examples of meanders. And they are considered, so if they need to be transverse, you want finitely many intersections. Each of them is simple, and you consider them up to homotopy. So, for example, you can notice that the first two are not equivalent because they do not have the same number of intersections, but the second one and the third one are the same. If you just move this piece to the right, there's a homotopy between these two. So, one convenient way to start recognizing them is, yeah, we will do that. Actually, we will choose one marked point so that everything can be easily identified. And this extra marking is actually extra, it's extra data. We will number one of the intersection points. So it's not there on the picture, but let's say we mark a point. And then we can sort of attribute numbers to all the intersection points and build a permutation out of it. So on the next picture, we will see how to represent the meanders in sort of canonical way. So this is a canonical way of representing the meander. This is the intersection point that you decided to mark. And then you just choose gamma 1 to be the real line of the sphere. And then you just plot the other one with arcs of circles. So this is the canonical way of writing a meander. So now a meander, you can think of it as the real line. And the rest is just a bunch of arcs on top and bottom. So far, so good. And what I will be dealing with is counting meanders, so counting how many such curves you have when the number of intersections go to infinity. So nobody knows how to do this, but we know something is when we count, but we care about how big are the faces. So what is a face? If you remove from the plane gamma 1 and gamma 2, you are left with some components. And each component is a polygon, right? You have a piece of gamma 2, then a piece of gamma 1, a piece of gamma 2, a piece of gamma 1. So here is a face with four sides. And so for each face, you attribute a number, which is W. So if the face has two J sides, you say that the degree is J minus 2. So why this curious way of counting? So here are the numbers for this example. And there are kind of two special faces, which are the top and the bottom, because they correspond to the face that touches infinity. But this piece of gamma 1 is the same as this piece of gamma 1. So when you count, you should take care of it. And as you can notice, the sum of these numbers is minus 4. And it's minus 4 because we are on the sphere. And as you will see later, these numbers will be related to the degrees of the zero of certain quadratic differential. And what we will be fixing is the number of minus 1 here. So, and these are bigons, right? There are two sides on the face. So you can either say that you fix the number of bigons. Here it will be 5, for example. Or that you fix the number of faces with degree minus 1. So first of all, we don't know how to count all meanders, so without this restriction on bigons. But there is a thing. Oh, first of all, yeah, let's see some numbers. So I will use these notations along the talk. So M index N A will be the number of meanders with 2n crossings and k bigons. Yeah, of course, the number of intersection is an even number because this is a bunch of arches, so it's even. So n is half of the number of intersections, which is 2n. K is the number of bigons. And mn will be the sum of the mnk, which is just the number of meanders with 2n crossings. And yeah, from the definition, you can took up a nice table. And so in columns are with fixed number of bygones. And at the very end is the sum of the rows. So yeah, here the row is stopped, so it will not sum up to this number here, but all the other ones are fine. And what we will be interested in this talk is the behavior of these columns. The behavior of the columns. How do they grow? Yes. You want to copy the number?
I'll ask you for your slides.
Good. So I recall that Mn is the number of members with twin crossings, and there is a famous conjecture, which is this one, due to Di Francesco Golinelli-Vitter from the late 90s. And it says that the number of members should grow exponentially. So this is this r to the n. And r, you can estimate it just computing the number of members with 50 intersections. And it gives you an approximation of this number. 50 is already a pretty big number, but this is more or less the limit of nowadays computations. And the interesting part of the conjecture is that you have a correcting term n to the minus alpha, and they do predict a formula for this alpha, which is 29 plus square root of 148 over 12. So you might wonder, where does this come from? And you will be right. And the point is that in these kind of models, there are several models that have the same scaling limits, and this alpha is robust with respect to scaling limits. So this is something in probability, like interpolation and things like that. And the point is that they come up with another model with whom they conjecture that they should have the same scaling limit, which is a loop model in statistical physics. And in this model, this is the alpha that is there. So this is why they come up with this number. And the conjecture has been tested very intensively by Jensen and Gutmann. So they did huge computation of Mn, up to 50, basically. And doing some clever thing, you can estimate the alpha, and they tend to confirm that this alpha looks good. So this is a challenging conjecture. And nobody knows what R should be, so there are approximations. Okay, so this is not about today's talk, about statistical physics. Today's talk is about N and K, so number of meanders.
What is the motivation to study meanders?
It's statistical physics where you have it's a complicating. Yeah, statistical physics. You count model, you fix constraints, and you look how many objects you have of given size. And meanders is kind of complicated because you have long range interactions. Because if you start meandering like this, you have to go out. So it's sort of complicated object to count, but that still have exponential growth. So it's like self-avoiding walks or thing like this, where you have these long range interactions, which makes it hard to count. So it's a simple model in the sense that it's easy combinatorially, but already hard to compute with. I think this is motivation. There might be more motivation. Yeah, it's also related to some things in physics, like temporally algebra, if you know. Okay. There are relations with other things in statistical physics and algebra. Okay, so this is about today. M and K is the number of members with K bygones. And for this, we do have a nice formula. No, a nice asymptotic formula, not a nice formula. So, as you will see later, there needs to be a summation over all n smaller than x, otherwise the function looks a bit crazy. You will see pictures later on. But if you do this averaging, then you have a nice asymptotic formula, which involves some power of pi and binomial coefficients. And the main point is that the only occurrence of x on the right side is this x which is here. So this grows polynomial. When you fix k, the growth is polynomial, and the coefficient of the polynomial is just this coefficient on the left. And this is true for all. Bigger than 4, of course, on the right, there is no. So far, so good. And yeah, you can compute what this constant is for some small example. So Mn4, which is the smallest example, you get 6 over pi squared. And you already recognize a nice number. For Mn5, you get 80 over 3 pi 4, which is less common number, and yeah, you can continue the list. What's next? So yes, how do we prove this? It's going through square tile surfaces. So let me first make the link with square tile surfaces. So what is a square tile surface? You have squares and you glue them by translation. Yes, I'm missing some size here. So here is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 squares. And there is a rule to glue them. You are not allowed to do anything. You are only, so they are oriented with squares and you are only allowed to glue them east with west or north with south, but you are not allowed to do quarter turn when you glue them. So half turn is authorized, like the DD that is here, but no quarter turn. And you want the resulting surface to be of genus 0. We are in genus 0. And the surface that I constructed here is an example in Q1 minus 1 to the 5th. And the singularities are the things with the signs that we have. So this dot, which is the same as this point, which is the same as this point, is the singularity of angle 3 pi. And that minus 1 to the 5th are the crosses. Okay, and yeah, when you have square tile surfaces, you can associate curves to it. And since I'm on the sphere, I will get curves on the sphere, and this is where meanders are. So these are the curves. There is a red curve, which is at the middle of the squares. So, and there is a blue curve, which is the vertical lines going through the middle of the squares. So they are not curves, actually. They are multi-curves.
So I wrote something.
Yeah, it's horizontal curves. So in general, if you do this, you don't have a curve, you have several components. And as you can see, the red curves, there are three components. This one is one curve. They are grouped here to here. This one is one curve, and this one is one curve. You have three components. But the vertical one is already one component, because D is blue to D, B to B, A to A, C to C. So blue is one component, and red is three components. And meanders will be exactly the one for which red is one component and blue is one component. So this is where the correspondence comes from. And this is the object of the next slide. So because I fixed the number of bigons, you should think of the strata to being grouped together when you fix the number of poles. So yeah, this one is already one stratum, this one also. But yeah, Q06 for me would be the union of these two strata, which is Q12 minus 1 to the 6, 2 minus 1 to the 6. And when you use this notation, the MNK that I defined before as being the number of members with 2 intersection and K bigons is just N times, there should be 2N times the sum of our square tile surfaces so that they have only one cylinder horizontally of height 1, one cylinder vertically of size 1, and you should sum up with this. You should care about automorphism of the surface because otherwise counting gets wrong. So this N here stands for marking, in the definition of a meander, I choose one intersection point. So this N stands for the choice of the intersection point. And you need to divide by automorphism because several choices of marking might end up with the same meander. And yeah, you sum over square tile surfaces with 2n squares, because you want 2n intersections. Yeah, as you can see in the previous picture, each intersection between blue and red corresponds to a square, right? So you have as many squares as intersections. So here I want to sum over S with 2n squares. Okay, to be sure that everybody understood, we can go the other way around, start from a meander and build a square tile surface. And this is, this boils down just to construct the dual graph of this picture. So what is the dual graph? You put a point in each face of the, what you get by removing the two curves from the plane. So you have one point in each face. So these are the crosses and the circles, and there is this one. And you put an edge where there was an edge before. So for example here, there was a blue edge here, and you just drew an edge joining the two faces. So this is just the dual graph, what I had before. And from the dual graph, you can redraw it. Oh, it's an extra. Okay, you can number can give names to the edges. And I did give name because I wanted to read. So this is the same drawing, drawn differently. But you can figure out that the combinatorics is just the same. So this meander corresponds to this squatter surface. And you can check that the vertical is actually only one D, D, G, G, P, B, H, H, C, C. So this is only one component of the blueprint. So yeah, just to resume quickly, I want to count squatter surfaces, but only a small subset of them, which is the one with one horizontal component and one vertical component only. So how do you do this? Actually, we don't do this. Sorry, this is the summary. This is the formula for the number of meanders, and this is what we will prove. We consider the set of square type surfaces with only one horizontal cylinder with height 1, the one with one vertical cylinder of height 1, and we will just prove this formula, which is the same as the initial formula because of this. So we want to count special square tiled surfaces where we fix something about the horizontal and something about the vertical. So we don't know how to do this, but we know how to compute square tiled surfaces. Yeah, precisely. CH is easy to compute, the asymptotic growth. And we will use this. So in which, so this is the same theorem we showed before. And the aim is to show this nice formula, which allows to compute this constant from other asymptotics. So the C of something is just the constant you have to put in order to get the right asymptotics.
So can I ask, sorry,
yeah, if sure.
When you have some large K and you have six, so you're allowing in the stratum Q 1 1
minus
two simple zeros and six simple poles are ordered
two and
so it's all contained in
and
you're counting
zero,
in all
and zero K. Yes,
that's all zero K.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
But we can also do the counting in each stratum.
Okay.
For all the talk, it will be all grouped together with given number of points. Yeah. But when you do the counting, the thing is that the asymptotics will be governed only by the principal stratum, which has larger dimension. So the exponent that you get here corresponds to the dimension of this stratum, and because all the other strata have lower dimension, they do not count in the asymptotics. So you can restrict, from now on, we will restrict the principal stratum, which is the only one we care about. Okay, and what I was telling you is that this sequence here is a crazy sequence. We will see pictures later on. But we know how to deal with simpler things, which is the right-hand side here. So counting surfaces where you only have restriction on horizontal, like CH, or only restriction with vertical, which are symmetric things, are easy to deal with. And this global asymptotic of square-tiled surfaces is something already studied and is related directly to the Masurich volume of the stratum. So what I will explain is that there is this formula, and I will explain you also how to compute each of these three numbers. And yeah, there is a magic going on because this is kind of weird sequence. Okay, I think. Oh yes, and the second step of the proof, computing everything. Okay, yeah, I lied. There is one case where we can compute everything, which is Q minus 1 to the 4, which corresponds to rotations. It's the same thing as H0. And in this case, the set of all square-tiled surfaces is just sigma of n, where sigma of n is the sum over the divisor function, sum over divisor of n. The CH is actually just n. And the intersection of the two, you can find out that it is phi, the Euler function, so the number of numbers smaller than n, relatively prime to n. And from this, you can already compute the asymptotic of everything. There are well-known theorem that you have asymptotic, you have average growth for these two functions. And you can check that the formula I gave here holds. I don't know if you already plotted this phi and this sigma, but it's a nice exercise to do. So this is a plot of sigma. So sigma is you count all square guide surfaces in depending on n. So the x-axis here is n, so number of squares. And here is sigma n divided by n. So forget about the colors for now. This is just a plotting of the sequence. And the black thing is just the mean average, which is pi per over 6. So you might think that this sequence sigma n over n is bounded, but this is not the case. It diverges, yeah, the highest point corresponds to the numbers with a lot of divisors. But this might be arbitrary peak. What is more interesting is that, say, the colors is the one interesting feature of the picture, is that if you look at restriction modulo 6, it gives you some information about divisor, of course. And if n is congruent to 0 mod 6, it means that 2 and 3 are already divisors, and it implies immediately that sigma is already somehow big, and you can see that on the picture. And if n is 1 or 5, you do not have 2 or 3 as a divisor, and as a consequence, your value of sigma needs to be low. And so if you plot with respect to these congruences, you sort of see levels in the picture.
Are all of the colors on top?
Yes, yeah, I think so, yeah. Because you just fix the first divisor and then you pick a product of the rest, so yes. At the same speed, and the divergence is log log n, so it's very small. Okay, and if you look at phi n over n, this is a nicer sequence because phi n is smaller than n, so it's bounded by 1. And the points that are there are the prime numbers because phi of prime number is p minus 1. So this is x minus 1 over x. It converges to a line, so you see a line because I started at 100. And here the colors are sort of better shaped. They are sort of limited. And you see that basically the colors are reversed. So the colors are the same congruences, but colors are reversed. Right? So red is in top here, and red is in the bottom here. And the prime numbers are here.
Could you move to the side where you're getting Alex?
Oh, I'm sorry. So there is some arithmetic involved, and yeah, you can explain that easily for k equal 4 because we have explicit formulas.
Is the ordering explained?
The ordering?
The colors?
Yes. Just because if n is congruent to 0 mod 6, you need to delete all divisors of 2, which is already half of the number less than n, and the multiple of 3. So you erase a lot, yeah, you need to be smaller than, yeah, this gives you a definite amount of phi n being smaller than n. And so you can, I don't know how sharp the statement can be, but this is good.
You're saying that 6 plays no particular role.
No, 6 plays no particular role. 6 was to fix the behavior with respect to the prime 2 and the prime 3.
Yes.
Because phi n, you can compute, if you know the divisors of n, you can compute phi n. And this was done in order to fix the divisors of n. So this is about k equal 4, and things become interesting with k equal 5. And as I told you, I want to reduce the computation of this intersection with computation of the square tag surfaces and the square tag with a fixed behavior with respect to the horizontal direction. And I did not lie because you can actually compute exactly a formula for these two. So it's very explicit somehow. You see that there is a sigma as before, but there is a sigma 3. And the sigma 3 is just the sum of divisors, but of third powers of divisors. This one is also nice. Before, for k equal 4, it used to be just n. Now it's a nice polynomial. Actually, yeah, it's a binomial correction. But yeah, this guy that we don't know so much about, we know the asymptotic, as I told you in the theorem, but we have no idea about what it could be as a sequence of numbers. So we just have the average asymptotic. But still, we can do pictures. This is a sort of general thing that you can come up with. the counting here, counting all square direct surfaces, you can always do it involving sigmas and product of sigmas and things like this, and it comes from quasi-modularity. Quasi-modularity is basically the same thing as saying that you have a formula like this for the number of square direct surfaces. This one here, it's an easy computation, and it's always a rational multiple of this binomial coefficient. But yeah, as I said in this example, there is no formula for discounting. And so this is why it's a bit striking to have this asymptotic formula. Pictures. So next slide should be equivalent. So this is the number of all square direct surfaces. So before it used to be sigma n over n, now it's this more complicated formula over n cubed. And yeah, you make the picture and you see this. And as before, they are nicely lined up with respect to divisors. You can also figure that out from the formula, that you have some kind of layers depending on your prime divisors. But it looks nicer than before. Somehow, they are more separated with respect to their prime divisors. I don't know if it's something general, but you can sort of see that on the picture. And what is more interesting is the next picture, which is the picture of the number of meanders with 5 bicons. And you see this picture. So we don't know what the sequence is, but there is a nice lining up with this number of divisors. And the pattern looks nice. But there is something very weird here. If you notice, the congruence has changed from this slide to this slide. So this is not taking count of whether 2 or 3 are divisors. It's just some crazy... I don't know why there is such a... yeah, such arithmetic going on, but yeah. There is sort of mystery under this sequence MN5, even if it looks kind of beautiful on this picture. Yeah, and as before, this is the average number, which is this.
The average repels.
The average repels, yeah, this is kind of fun. I don't know if it's a general picture. Okay, good. What I want to do is to prove the formula that the number of meanders is the number, the asymptotic of meanders is given by the product of the asymptotic where you fix the horizontal and vertical divided by this thing, which is nothing else than the Mazurich form. And this formula, you can think of it as an asymptotic independence of probabilities. Because if you divide both sides by this quantity, this would be the asymptotic ratio of meanders among all square direct surfaces. This will be the asymptotic ratio of horizontal ones and this of vertical one. And then it just this formula tells you that you have independence between fixing horizontal behavior and vertical behavior. But there is one delicate point in doing this, is that you need to prove that these numbers do exist. I told you there is a formula, but first you have to prove that this number makes sense. So this is actually the hardest step in the proof. And so actually we prove something better, is that you even have so you have uniform densities rather than densities. So just to have more pictures, let me state the theorem about Z2. If you have an open set in R2 and you want to compute its volume, you just count the number of intersections with the rescale lattice, lambda, and you get the volume divided by epsilon squared. And I want to play the same game with the square direct surfaces and my subfamilies of square direct surfaces. So the nice analog of square direct surfaces in R2 are the relatively prime numbers. So these are the PQ, so that P and Q are relatively prime. And here you have the same statement that if you pick any open set U and you rescale this picture by epsilon, so making it very small, you get a number, which is the density of this set, times the volume divided by epsilon. So you can think of the number that is in front here as the density of this, but it's density that is also uniform in some sense. And we will prove that all the set of square direct surfaces that I presented have actually these uniform densities. So this is just a definition of what would be a density. So you have a set of square tiled surfaces that can be either square tiled, the square tile is fixed horizontal, fixed vertical, or both. And you wonder whether there exists such a constant delta of D, so that you have this formula, where mu of Mazurovich is the Mazurovich measure, but not as in the last talk. This is not renormalized. This is not a probability measure. This is like the Lebesgue measure on C to the D. So far, so good. By construction of the Mazurovich measure, if you count all square tiled surfaces, it's basically all lattice points, and you get delta equal 1. Let me just also tell briefly that for experts that you can also define all of these for things defined over Q, because here you have the notion of square tiled surfaces, but just a small remark. This density and C are basically the same thing. You just have to multiply by this normalizing constant, which is the Mazurovich measure of the unit hyperbolus, the thing that people usually compute when they do compute. So, the equivalence of the theorem about the C's, you can reformulate it about the delta, and this is the statement. And this is what I'm going to prove, is that the proportion of surfaces with fixed horizontal and vertical combinatorics is the product of the density. And actually, the whole proof, you can basically copy-paste the arguments that... you can sort of abstractly copy-paste the steps of the proof when she's doing the computation about single closed geodesic on hyperbolic surfaces.
Epsilon?
Yeah.
I think I missed it. What was epsilon D? What did it mean to scale D by epsilon? Maybe I missed this one.
D is the dimension of the space.
No, epsilon script D. On the left side.
On the left side here?
Yeah.
Oh, this is rescaling. Yeah, you pick your square tile, you multiply the surface by epsilon, making a square.
Both
directions. So if this was tiled by squares of psi 1, you get squares surface tiled by epsilon by epsilon squares. Squares of psi epsilon by epsilon. So this is just multiplying the surface. And the metric. And so what are the steps? First is the hardest part is to prove that the density exists as a whole, so that you have numbers, so that this asymptotic makes sense. And this is where the two approach of Mariam and ours differ, because here we use flat surfaces very hardly, and she was using Weyl-Pedersen volumes. But the first step is the same, you have to prove that you have densities. And we only prove densities for the first step, only for the CHCB, but not for the intersection CHC. And then there is a magic trick that allows you to pass from a density, like just global counting, from a uniform density. That means that your set is equidistributed. And this is by just using ergodicity of the action of this guy and this guy. And the point is that if you fix horizontal combinatorics, your set of square tiled surfaces is invariant under this horizontal Borel cycle. So if you have limiting distribution, you will get something which is invariant under this, and you can apply ergodic tool to prove that you need to be the Mazurovich measure, and then that your set is equidistributed. And with CV, you just play with this one. And there is also this step in Marianne's work, and she's using just the action of the mapping class group on PML, but this is basically the same argument. And the third step, so far, I did not claim that we know how to prove that delta this set has a density, but this is the third step, basically, that you prove that if you have a constraint on the horizontal and the vertical, then the density get this nice formula. And this is because you have a product structure on strata. And the product structure, what is it? It's just the horizontal and the vertical. So you have nice coordinates on strata, given by the real part and the imaginary part. And if you say something on the real part, it determines the vertical cylinders, and the same with the horizontals. And in small boxes, it is easy to prove this formula. So you prove this for a cube in your stratum, and since you have uniform densities, you get this formula for the whole for this asymptotes. So this is the way we prove that this density actually exists, and this is why we have no hand on the actual sequence, but just on the asymptotes. What's next? So so now I basically prove that you have this nice formula and we have density for everything. But then we have to compute, and this is the last step, to put actual numbers on all of this. And there are two things to compute: the global the Mazurovich volume of this principal strata, and this has been done by JLF Afria, Etzeskin, and Anton Zorich. And you have this very simple formula for the principal stratum in genus 0. And this is not really a theorem, this is very easy. This does not matter. The hard part is definitely here. But this is important to get the formula for the other.
It's height 1, right?
Here, yes, height 1. Yes. Oh, yes, not of height, yes, but of height 1. Indeed. Thank you. Let me tell some words about the proof of this one. Because actually, it's a proof, but it's just to mention that the formula, you can recognize this guy and this guy. So it's much that. And there are some normalizing constants that make this appear. This is just for markings of the zeros and the poles. And these two, there are some four and some twos that you have to do. I want to say some words about this. The asymptotic of all square tight surfaces. And first of all, it was an old conjecture of Koncevich, I think, even before 2000. And as I told you, the generating theory is somehow nice because it's a quasi-modular form. And you can obtain explicit formula involving sigmas, but the formula gets more complicated and more complicated. And the way they obtain this simple formula at the end is because they use something else. And this something else is really convoluted, at least to my mind, is that they use the fact that there is no Lyapunov exponent for lambda plus. Lambda plus is just the bundle. There is no homology on the sphere. So you know that lambda plus is zero. But Etzeskin-Koncevich-Zorich tells you something about the relations with the Siegel-Wiech constants and the fact that lambda plus is just the sum of something plus the Siegel-Wiech constant, and basically they tell you what is the Siegel-Wiech constant. So you have formula for the Siegel-Wiech constant, and from there you can extract formula for the volume, because the Siegel-Wiech constant is also a sum of our boundary strata and of the volumes. So you have basically infinitely many equations for the volumes coming from this, and then you have to solve this equation. And this is what they do in the article, solving these infinitely many equations, showing that this is the only solution to the equation. But they wrote down also explicitly what should be proven to prove that more directly, but there is no proof that it actually works. This is the hard part of the counting. And the easy part of the counting, let me just go through this. If you want to count the surfaces with one cylinder of height 1, you have to make this picture, which is a cylinder. And you have some gluing patterns on the bottom and on the top. So this is an example of Q1 minus 1 to the fifth. And you just have to count how many parameters will give you square tile surface of fixed area. And so what are the parameters? They are the lambdas, which are the lengths of the things on the top and the bottom. And you have four of them here. And you have an equation, because the length of the bottom needs to be the length of the top. So you have this equation here. And there is this twist parameter that you have to care. But in the end, you get some number, rational number, times n over 2 times n. This n cares about the tau, and this n over 2 cares about this equation. And h is fixed to be 1, so you can forget about it. The area is just n, the width of the cylinder. And then, this is for one such separatrix cylinder diagram which is fixed. And the one thing which is not that simple is to make the sum of all possible combinatorics of cylinders. Because there is an once you have a cylinder diagram, it's easy to come with the rational number that is here, which is basically given by the automorphism of this thing. But then you need to sum over all possible separatrix diagrams. And luckily, we are on the sphere. And on the sphere, as we saw in Paul's talk, everything is counted by trees. So basically, you end up with a formula involving counting of trees. And you can prove this. But it's just it's playing with binomials. And it's not completely trivial, but it's not that far coming to this. And I think that's the last slide.
Do you have any estimate on the deviation from the asymptotic that you have? How much can deviate from it?
Yes and no.
Yes and no.
Yes and no, yeah, because there are several numbers. Yeah. For this one, yes.
Okay.
For this one, yes, because there are formulas, but yeah, for the one, the meanders, we have noise. And this is actually, part of the challenge is to give an estimate of the convergence speed of this. And so far, there is no idea, but this should be related to the to some speed of distribution, how well the horizontal and vertical intersects. And in the case of Marianne, this would be related to the how ergodic is the action of and the mapping class group on piano. But it's hard to find a formulation that would translate from ergodic to here. But in the experiments, you see here, that it looks very nice. And actually, if you do the error, it looks like it's n to the 3, so that you have a degree less in the asymptotic. But this is just experimental, the n to the 3.
So what prevents you from summing over k and obtaining the formula in Francesco?
It does not work. Sadly, it does not work. If you sum over k, you obtain something different. And the problem is that the problem, if you look at the very beginning, to the numbers, the problem is that the problem is that the distribution is concentrated very to the right. The big numbers, you see that in this row, the big numbers are here, which is at the very beginning of, we are studying by columns, and the big numbers in a given row appear in the beginning of the asymptotic somehow, and our convergence is not accurate for this given n.
So you have the asymptotic?
Yeah, we have the asymptotic here, and it doesn't tell you about the row, sadly. But it would have been fun to find the same numbers this way.
Anybody else?